Catapult is a training and competition program that boosts European healthcare startups that are absolutely top-notch. I'd like to introduce you to four other companies that have participated in this program in the category MedTech. Let's look at a little video.
Aortic diseases are one of the silent killers of modern society.
Current treatments present severe limitations and must be replaced. Today, open repair is still the preferred option, despite unacceptably high mortality rates due to its invasiveness. Endovascular repair, less invasive, reduces mortality drastically, but fails over time.
Aortic was founded by the perfect combination of chemists, engineers, and one of the top 10 aortic surgeons in the world to change the paradigm of how aortic diseases are treated.
We have invented and patented a disruptive device. It consists of a bioresorbable patch that navigates through the aorta, bends at the entry tear, adheres against the aorta, plugs the leak, and then initiates a local regeneration of the aorta.
We have designed the entire system, including the catheter, the deployer, the patch, and its adhesive. Our solution directly answers the needs of a market of more than $3 billion worldwide. If you are an investor, then trust us and support us to give a better life to aortic disease patients. In all cases, think aorta and think aortics.
Each year, millions of people suffer bone fractures and diseases like osteoporosis. Globally, 2.5 million bone grafts are carried out annually, a number that will rise in line with extended life expectancy. Currently, graft procedures are fraught with issues, such as potential body rejection in the case of xenografts, and for autografts, the need for two painful operations. Zoan Biomed provides a better alternative. Our approach involves the development of bioactive devices derived from sustainably grown marine coral. Similar to human bone structure, strength, and porosity, coral has proven to be very effective for orthopedic surgery. When harvested, refined into granules, and implanted into the trauma site, our coral treatment will safeguard against infection, reduce surgery time, and accelerate healing. We will soon launch our independently validated bioactive granule for trauma applications, Zoan G3, followed by a bioactive putty for osteoporotic fractures, and a truly disruptive solution to advanced spinal surgery.
Challenging clinical pictures, such as complex aortic aneurysms, may require a personalized implant. We founded Paragraft in 2019 as a spin-off of RWTH Aachen University. Our goal is to design, produce, and deliver patient-individualized endovascular implants in a fraction of the time. Everything we do is based on our ambition and passion to create each single implant to perfectly match the patient's individual needs. We build to order. We design each implant based on the patient's requirement, the doctor's therapy plan, and our collective expertise. Our combined software and hardware approach enables us to deliver the personalized implant to the point of care in only 5 days. Our product platform serves the entire aorta, starting from the heart down to the iliac arteries in the legs. We want to serve the aortic community by delivering best-in-class treatment options through individualization. Let's make this vision come true together, assuring a safe and secure flow of life.
Hello, I am Dave Varanghi, the CEO of Wear Health. We develop medical-grade wearable vital signs monitors for use in hospitals and in patients' homes. Our monitors are continuous, spotting improvement or deterioration at the earliest moment. If we take sepsis as one example, for every hour it is undetected, your chances of death increase by 4%. Within the first few moments, however, Sentinel will have detected the fever and its AI will already be pointing towards sepsis. Sentinel can do this even without a network connection. It works off-grid. The EU discharged 80 million patients last year. 14% of them were readmitted as an emergency. Continuous monitoring reduces emergency readmissions and deaths. Innovation is at the heart of our products. A battery life of 8 days is significant as the average length of stay is 6.3 days. Nobody has to charge the battery. Recording a continuous cuffless blood pressure is unique, allowing patients to have uninterrupted sleep. If we take drug titration and hypertension as one example, getting the balance of drug combinations and dosage right against side effects can take years. Sentinel spots improvement or deterioration in hours. Now consider that 40% of the Western world suffers from hypertension, and Sentinel can make a large global difference. Thank you.
Now, let's meet these four companies live. And of course, there is plenty of room for your questions as well, so keep sending those in. I would now like to hand over to Elsa Papadopoulou, who will be moderating this panel. Go ahead, Elsa.
Thank you very much, Anne-Marie, and welcome to our panelists. So now we shall commence with the first round of our questions. It's going to be one question to all of our panelists. The first question goes as follows. What is your most important and impactful selling point that you can offer to an investor and to the future users? On the basis of this question, we shall commence our discussion, and beginning with the company Aortix and Mr. Jordi Martorell. Jordi, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Elsa. Well, I think that that we are the first really unique solution for dissections, no? And that we have done such a cool job by building a structure that has the same mechanical properties as the aorta. It pulses along with the aorta. It's really like what we call a biomimetic, no? We're just integrated and trying to regenerate from the inside. So it sounded like magic, no? A couple of years ago, but we're starting to demonstrate that this is not magic. This can work, and that's where we are right now. Then there's other things that investors love, no? Like less cost of goods or more market, all these things. But we as scientists, it's like, wow, we're making magic happen. No? So that's one of the things we love about our product, and it's one of our selling points.
Okay, thank you very much. Just to mention that Aortix is a company that was founded back in 2018 by four Catalan researchers. One of them is one of the top 10 aortic surgeons in the world. After raising more than 2 million euros between a seed round and different grants, the company has advanced powerfully in their preclinical assays and is now raising an 8 million euro Series A. Congratulations on this, Jordi. And now I shall pass the floor to Zoyan Biomed at Declan. So just a short introduction. Zoyan Biomed are based in the naturally diverse environs of Connemara and are leading a revolution in orthopedics. Zoyan have developed the next generation of bone graft devices to achieve better outcomes for bone trauma and bone disease patients around the world. Uniquely, they grow tropical marine coral and sustainably harvest their scaffolds to make all natural, safe, and highly effective devices for surgeons. So, Declan, the floor is yours with these amazing innovations.
Thanks very much, Elsa. I think from an investor point of view, what we believe makes us to be an excellent investment opportunity is our ability to deliver disruptive innovations to market, and we can do this, you know, cost effectively. We can do this with a pretty unique environmental and sustainable agenda. From a patient point of view, it's those same innovations which help to heal bone faster. So our launch product, our Zone G3 device, is implanted by a surgeon, and because it's a coral-based device, it's entirely in tune with the bone and the patient's own body, and that's from both an architectural point of view and from a composition point of view. So uniquely for patients, we can deliver a natural stimulus because of the biomimetic nature of it.
Okay. Would you like to add something more?
Well, certainly. I mean, I think this, you know, this really allows us to reduce the amount of time in hospitals, because the industry is now moving towards, you know, much more cost competitive and integrated healthcare. So really trying to reduce hospital stays. So from a patient and a surgeon point of view, the benefits that we can bring in terms of the accelerated acceptance of these devices, the innovations that we can bring, because we're now working with, you know, an extraordinary microfabrication platform. And of course, this is not something that's done in a lab with chemicals and sintering temperatures. This is something that's done in a natural environment by a marine coral with an extraordinary output, you know?
Okay, excellent. Thank you very much, Declan. And now I shall move on with another company, and that's Perigraft. Perigraft's vision is to start a new era in patient-centric care by combining speed, precision, and simplicity to deliver patient individualized implant solutions. Their goal, is to develop, produce, and deliver these implants for a range of cardiovascular applications. And the first focus of the company is a novel patient individualized stent graft to treat complex aortic aneurysms. So here we have Valentine, who's going to share with us more information on Perigraft. Valentine, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Elsa. So in our point of view, what we bring to the table and our unique selling point is really what you just mentioned in the introduction. It's really to combine precision and speed to deliver the best patient individualized solution for each patient, and really like focusing on the individual patient, but bringing this into an ecosystem and bringing this into an entire process, starting from the image and the diagnosis in the hospital, and really bringing it all the way through until therapy, and like making sure that we really have the best solution in a matter of time that really matters to the surgeons and to the patients, in order to be able to give them this best therapy option. And so, as just mentioned, from a user point of view, it's like the vascular surgeons are the first customers on our side. And here it's really about, I would like to point out three main aspects, which is like defining, designing, and delivering. So together with the surgeons, we want to define the best solution based on their experience and their know-how. We will then design the individualized implant based on our process know-how and our know-how in the behavior of the implant itself. And then the delivery point, we can actually say it's in two parts. So it's from our side, delivering in the fastest speed so that the implant is available at the point of care when it's needed. And on the other hand, it's also about delivering the implant into the human body. So making sure that the surgeon has an easy delivery system, which is intuitive to use, so that they can have an easy procedure when delivering the implant.
Okay, excellent. Thank you very much, Valentin. And now moving on to our fourth company, which was formerly known as Sentinel Biosensor and has been recently baptized to Wear Health. And we have today with us Dave Harangi, if I pronounce your family name correct, Dave. So Wear Health is a Scottish company who develop medical-grade continuous vital signs monitors that have consumer levels of usability. Our sensors work anywhere and are not, their sensors work anywhere and are not reliant on a network connection. Continuous monitoring detects deterioration at the earliest moment, delivering early treatment and improved outcomes. Dave, the floor is yours.
No, the pronunciation of the name was great. Something we maybe share in common.
I was wondering, Aberdeen. Can get used to it.
Yeah. So I think, you know, from an investor's perspective, it's really the size of the market and the vision. We look at, you know, patient discharges, and currently 14% of all discharges are readmitted as an emergency. You know, and if you take even something like your car, it monitors itself more than we monitor humans when we send them home. So, you know, there's a huge market for that level of monitoring, which is quite, you know, ununderstandably new. Monitoring people at home is something that's not been going on before. So you're taking medical devices and making them that consumers can use them. This has to involve, you know, you can go for a shower with it, you can treat it as though you're not wearing it. And so, you know, that's kind of, I think, what most investors see in us at the moment.
Okay, excellent. Thank you very much. And now I think we can move on to the second question. So, starting again with Jordi, the question goes as follows. So, Jordi, in your opinion, is public funding for medtech important and why? Also, which gap or gaps can it fill in that a VC or a CVC cannot potentially do so? Jordi, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Well, we're facing, and now especially in Europe, a huge problem, no? And especially for medtech startups, that is that a new, very comprehensive, and I think very logical medical device regulation has come up. And it implies humongous costs nowadays for our products to move from the lab to the market. No, we had a more soft and probably worse medical device directive back in the day, but medtech has changed, and in Europe it becomes more complicated to reach market. So it means more money for probably the same benefits, no? So for the same so the same revenues. So in the end, we are losing competitivity in a sense. So now, from, let's say, from proof of concept to the market, the cost has increased dramatically. And some VCs, they are not ready or happy with this increasing of costs, because in the end, their opportunity is lower. No, so we need now more public funding to cover this gap between a good proof of concept, no, good development until the market, because the investors, they are not really willing most of the times to cover this extra cost that this new public, no, regulation has brought, and that's where a better public funding or competitive funding by people like EIT can help a lot in this in bridging the gap. No, and that's, I think it's very important, and I think we can construct it from the EAD Health Amplifier, the SME Accelerator, all these things. They're there, and they're gonna be a lot of people asking for it.
Okay, thank you, Jordi. Declan, your views.
Yeah, I mean, I would add to what Jordi is saying there, and that public funding plays, particularly at that early innovation stage when you're looking for the first validations. I know in our journey, we were very lucky to be able to engage with our regional authority, with the Lawson Great Doctor, and also with our Enterprise Ireland. And we were able to draw down relatively modest public funds, but that allowed us to do some of our initial in vitro validations with the Regenerative Medicine Institute in the University in Galway. So all of a sudden, we were making real progress, and it really enabled the conversations with our, in our case, our seed angels, you know. So we had a great backlog of catalog of scientific data to show, yes, this works, and we can now show you why it works. And that was a huge bonus for us. I think the other area that the public funding plays a particularly important role, I mean, I know in Ireland we're very lucky in that we have a skills net, which really does offer, you know, incredible training right across the sector, which is not something that could be done on a private basis. So that's very important. And also it's obviously stimulating accelerators. You know, again, in Ireland and Galway, we're very proud of one we have called BioInnovate. And that does use quite a degree of public funding to progress projects and concepts up to commercialization and pre-investment stage. So it helps to populate the ecosystem with potential pipeline. So I think it's hugely important, yeah. Thanks.
Excellent. Thank you very much. And Valentine, what do you think?
Yeah, I think a lot has already been said. I would like to emphasize on what Jordi and Declan said. So same for us. We had a German Exist grant, which helped us through this first validation phase and really getting out of the lab into getting some validation and data to be able to show that it really works, up to preclinical work, I would say. And I think it's at all stages, really, in this first beginning phase, it's going to be very, very important. But up to commercialization, there's really in each stage, each milestone that you hit with public funding is going to help you step forward, bringing the evidence that investors want to see. And so I think it has a huge impact, and especially programs such as EIT Health or the EIC Accelerator, they're really impactful drivers in helping to develop and grow kind of this next generation of European winners from my point of view. And I think that in the medtech space, we really need that in order to keep up with all the worldwide companies that we face. So I would personally like to also, I would love to see a more industry-focused program to help like the medtech space, something like the MedTech EIC Accelerator. I think that would be a great idea to help to overcome the problems that Jordi mentioned, for example, and really make sure that we as Europe are able to foster disruptive technologies and really bring these new upcoming world-class European winners up there.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. Thank you very much, Valentin. Dave, the floor is yours.
Thanks. I agree, I think, with all of us in this medtech sector. Public finance and funding is just essential. Many investors or VCs, if you just tell them you've got an idea, they'll come back and say, well, maybe when you've got a prototype. And it's just that chicken and egg going round and round. So we were really lucky. In our case, it was Horizon 2020. So we turned an idea into something real. And at that point, yeah, people will then start, listening a bit more to you. But yeah, I think innovation from small companies is essential. On our journey, we were told by the larger companies, we don't innovate anymore. We're too big. By the time, we get this to market for us, it's 18 months, 2 years. But for you smaller, companies, you could move much more quickly. And that does bring innovation into the market, in smaller periods of time, which is really essential to keep going. So yeah, I totally agree. We definitely need public sector funding in most of what we do.
Excellent. Thank you very much. So I think now we have another 8 minutes left, and we get back to Anne-Marie.
Absolutely. I have in the meantime been monitoring the questions that have been coming in, and I have a few for you. This one is for all of you. First of all, have you had experience with crowdfunding, and what is your opinion about it? Who would like to jump in on that one? I see someone nodding there.
Yes, so we at Aorix, our seed round is a crowdfunding round. Okay, we are a little exceptional because we ran it without any crowdfunding platform, all right? So it's all about friends. I have very good friends and family, who's supportive. And we raised the largest crowdfunding round of 2019 without platforms of crowdfunding. So, and I think for us, I think the four of us are scientists. No, and when you have been bothering your entire family for and friends for 10 years about the cool things you do in the lab, and they always ask you, when are you going to make money out of it? So there's that moment, like, now. So
and I need you.
And I need you guys. So that's what we do. And I think if you're able to properly handle it, and if you select those who invest you, and you're able to tell those who cannot, there's sometimes friends who want to, but they don't have you know that not in such a good economic situation, these things, and you have to also tell them, no, I don't want your money, because sometimes that's important. And but it's a great way, as long as you don't have infinite questions from people who don't understand what you're doing. So it's really for me a matter of trust in the team and in the people. And that's our experience so far.
Right. Are any of you also experienced in this field, or is crowdfunding still a little bit of a new area? Somewhat new. I see some nodding.
We haven't taken that route yet. We've gone a more traditional route in terms of angel and matching funds. So we haven't tried the crowd route. So no, I can't help you there.
Would you maybe be interested to try it?
I would think that our next round might be, I would imagine with crowd that there's a lot of micromanagement. And I think that as you're raising investment, I think the less micro you have to do, the better. I think if you can bring in a different structure, it makes it easier to run your venture. You know, I think if you have a, particularly as the stakes get higher and the milestones get, you know, more serious, as Jordi mentioned, there would be a concern about the level of inquiry from having potentially so many individuals as investors. So that would be one area that would perhaps, you know, detract me from exploring it too much.
Yeah, that's a very important consideration as well. Thank you so far. And of course, also thank you, Elsa, for hosting this panel.